talked to Middle Lane, the people third degree and above, there weren't too many, had red pedals, maybe, and then his was bright and red. Anyways, because yours got screwed up, and so they came through white and red, white with red tips. So we're going from ways, like those would be his patch. True story.
And then the meaning made up afterward to...
No, the meaning of the drawing was what it was.
Okay.
So, there's 18 of them here, I think we got more than that in here, but you can have them. I don't have any more to give out, so. If anybody wants one.
Jeremy, do I have one? Leslie, put it on my chair.
So Mr. Arter asked me to talk a little bit about some things, and I may go shorter or longer than what he put down here. But did you get the point of the workout?
Yes, sir.
That's what the Kwamicon is about. You can tie any kind of philosophical thing you want into there. Mr. Harrison put a Zen color to some of it, Kwame Zen Gokai is where that came from, because he was interested in Zen for a while. I can tell you this, and we got involved with the karate study of Zen, went out the window. So think about how long ago that was. Anyways, history of ranking. It's modern. What's modern? What time frame?
1930s forward.
Maybe a little earlier. But yeah, 1930s, a lot of stuff was done about karate. So it says history ranking, it is modern, born from Kano. Yeah, they born from the judo people. Where did judo people get it from?
Jiu-jitsu.
Huh?
Jiu-jitsu.
Nah, judo and jiu-jitsu, that's not a draw distinction. Where'd they get it from? Kano created the system. Kano was an educator. So what he did was he took all this ragtag stuff that happens, and we see it today in a martial art, and they go to a Brims and go to a BJJ school over here and go to one over there. They teach them the same thing? No. It's just a hodgepodge. So what they do is go to a couple of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu clinics and go teach Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. So what do they teach? What they know. Right? What do instructors teach? What they know. Some go out and learn more and teach it, some don't. Some people learn how to grapple, and some people haven't. So he took this hodgepodge, and what he did was he made a system out of it in order to teach and to put it in the school systems. Okay? So you don't put stuff in the school systems without a lesson plan. Without guidelines. And then, since it's in the school districts, you have to test the students. This is all just a logical thing. It's nothing unusual, mystical, or anything else about it. Then, that system got started using in commercial schools. Okay? The idea of belt cover came up because another sport used gold, silver, and bronze levels. And so, Kano, don't use your belt colors. He just kind of looked at something somebody else was doing and said, okay, they've got levels and colors that they want to achieve where they're at. Who does gold, silver, and bronze? That's your homework assignment. All right. So what do we do with ranking today? What is ranking today? We all do it, so come on, you guys.
Like a landmark. Like it's like a landmark or a standard, that like the yellow belt means you've acquired this.
Yeah, like a landmark, yeah, you can tell. Yeah. So the instructor knows who knows what. Who knows what they're teaching, what curriculum they should have. We don't have for a second, third, fourth, fifth grade. And we don't have to give an ABCD test, do we? So we have all these people come in, and we have higher ranks and lower ranks, everybody all mixed together. Okay, so you organize based on the ranking. And it gives you a structure. In any kind of structure like that, everybody figures the person above is supposed to know more than the person below. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And we say that's your militaristic concept. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
How many people have been in the military? Who knows more? The NCO?
Sergeant.
Or the CO?
NCO.
NCO.
The NCO knows more about the inner workings of the organ, of how to make things happen than the officers, the commissioned officers. Okay, so now we have this concept, the military concept that we have in our heads. But is it a military concept, or is it just a construct of our ideas of what we think one is or should be? Does the U.S. Army promote based on competence?
No.
Pretty much though, if you're incompetent, you get thrown out of the system anyways. But they promote you based on time. To a good degree. It is possible somebody correctly moved a little faster than somebody else. But it's not based on that. Here's the problem with today's military. Okay? You're a really good officer. But you're the only officer your commanding officer has to evaluate. You got that?
He doesn't have any.
Your commanding officer has one officer underneath you, and that's you. Okay? How is your evaluator evaluated? They're going to evaluate him based on how he evaluates everybody else. So they're going to expect him to evaluate based on a bell curve. You're his only officer. Where is he going to value you at? Right here.
Mm-hmm.
Because if he's not there, then they're gonna look at how he's doing his job, they're gonna look at the fact that he's got his people balanced and that he is following the dictum that he is supposed to follow. That you put your people here, so many below, so many above. How do you get quality out of that? I don't know about the Marines, but that's what the Army is doing right now. Okay. So you see, things aren't always what we presume they are. Okay. But we are hierarchical in some military sets because the generals do what generals do, right? And the higher ranks do what the higher ranks do. So, you know, testing for black belt grades. How did the first people get their ranks? The guys who really ran the Shotokan system, how did they get their ranks?
Time in relationship with the people around them.
Well, they had a meeting, got together, and everybody agreed on what they would agree on. Mm-hmm. And they went forth from there. And set up their systems and did what they did. And so about the same time, Japanese, they had two universities. You know Shotokan? Why is Shotokan so prevalent? Does anybody know that? It's a prevalent style, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So you have two universities in Japan, right? That were Shotokan. You ever look at two practice from each university? They're not the same. Okay? One university, the science guys were involved in martial arts. You can look this up. Okay, I'm getting this from Joe. Information that I've read has been published. The other university was the business department. Which Shotokan do you think you see today?
Business.
Yeah. So, when they sent the Shotokan instructors over to the United States, okay, Okazawa was on the East Coast, Mikami was on the southern part, I forget the name of the guy in Illinois right now, I got his book out there, and then they had somebody in California, which is probably Oshima, but then Nishiyama got a hold of that. You know that story, don't you? Oshima was Nishiyama's instructor, at least higher up in hierarchy, and Nishiyama came in, and then Oshima asked him to take over his schools. He had to go back to Japan for a while, and he came back, and Nishiyama wouldn't give his schools back. Now, these are your heroes. Good martial artists. But, okay, so then Nishiyama disappears and doesn't pay taxes on the property.
Mm.
So then he gets in all kinds of tax trouble. And who has to bail them out?
Students.
I got the story right from Kanazawa. Here's one and a half of money. So I had to pay all the back taxes for him so he could keep the dojo so he took off with the other guy. You see, now you get the idea why it's all in the value of the practice. Because you get people from diverse groups, you get in here, you 1 or 2 hours, you work hard, you all try to do the same thing. There's no fun games about this. It's just punch, kick, move, get exercise. Develop your bodies. So, what is a senpai?
Pardon? A mentor?
Gary?
A mentor?
No, a senpai is not a mentor. Of course.
Somebody helps organize.
Senpai kohai relationship. Uh-huh. It's just student teacher relationship. Right?
Yes.
Okay. What does a sensei, shihan, han, si, so, ki, ren, shi, kyoshi? How do those all fit together? Not every style of martial arts has shihans. Some groups had them, some didn't. Today everybody uses them. Why do people call themselves shihans? Because they've been around longer than people calling themselves sensei. All right? So one guy decides that he's going to call himself a Shihan, and everybody else says, well, what's a Shihan next to him? He doesn't do that, I'm going to do that. So everybody in the same peer group starts calling themselves Shihan. Before too long, somebody who's a sensei is not a Shihan must become a Shihan. So why are you going to give him a Shihan? And you structure requirements. Why do you structure requirements? To enforce the hierarchy and keep yourself on top. So this system can be as clean and dirty as you make it, right?
Yeah.
We try to keep it clean in the parking lot. We try to keep it based on practice and commitment, not on all the other shenanigans. And Stanley used to say something that a person's personality flaws will rise to the surface and eliminate those who don't walk in martial arts. And we've seen that. Some of you guys have been around for a long time. You've seen people come and go, and you've seen their personality flaws come to fruition. Okay. So, when do you promote somebody to black belt?